Hello, dear viewers. Welcome to GCE Maths Panel and Maths 24 Super Channel. In this particular lesson, we are looking at the domain of functions. And our focus in this lesson will be on the domain of polynomial functions, logarithmic functions, exponential and rational functions, as well as composite functions. Our previous lessons were on domain, parity, and so on. And many other lessons will be coming up in this particular episode. Please make sure that you watch this lesson to the end and don't forget to click on the subscription button as you watch. You can equally join us on GCE Math Panel online classes or www.gcemathpanel.blogspot.com. Let us begin this lesson. So we start by looking at the domain of a function. And the domain of a function refers to the set of all values of x for which the function is defined or makes sense, or the values of x for which the function is not equal to infinity. The domain of definition, simply called the domain, actually is the set of all values of x for which the function is defined, the set of all those values. We will look at the domain of polynomial, rational, radical, exponential, logarithmic, and composite functions in this particular lesson. For example, if f of x is equal to infinity, then we say for this value of x, this function is undefined because infinity is not a number. It's just a description of how large the number is. So the function is undefined. This is infinity. The function is undefined or makes no sense at this particular value of x. Let us start by looking at the domain of polynomial functions. For all polynomial functions, the domain is the set of all real numbers. So it's very simple. For all polynomial functions, the domain is the set of all real numbers. For example, quadratic functions, x squared minus 4x plus 5, the domain for all quadratic functions, and even linear functions like 4 minus 3x, as well as cubic functions like x cubed minus 4x squared plus 3x minus 5 and 4, all these are polynomial functions. And the domain of all polynomial functions is given by the set of all real numbers. R, this special R, the set of all real numbers. Equally, this can be written in interval notation as from negative infinity to positive infinity. And you must take note of this sign at the beginning. This first sign means that this negative infinity is not included in the boundary. This other sign is not also closed, meaning that positive infinity is not included because these are not numbers, these are just descriptions. So for all polynomial functions, this is rule number one, the domain is a set of all real numbers and it can be written using this, the set of real numbers, or we can write it in interval notation as we have seen. Next, we look at the domains of rationals. A rational function is just a fraction. And a function that is considered to be rational is such that there is an unknown in the denominator. If there is no variable in the denominator, then it is not considered a rational function. So a rational function is a fraction with a variable in its denominator. In simple terms, with x in the denominator, if the function is a function of x. So to get its domain, there are three things we do. First of all, we inequate the denominator to zero, that the denominator should not be equal to zero. Then we solve for x, and thirdly, we exclude this value of x from the set of real numbers. So there are three things. The first thing is to inequate the denominator to zero. Number two, we solve for x, and number three, exclude this value of x from the set of real numbers. Let's take an example. Determine the domain of definitions of the given functions. The first one, you have f of x equals x squared minus 4x plus 5 on x minus 3. And the other function, you have g of x equals 2x on 5 minus 4x. So for these functions, we first of all ask ourselves this question. Is this a rational function? The first one, yes, it's a rational function because it has x in the denominator. Because first of all, it's a fraction. And secondly, there is a variable in the denominator, in this case, x. So we are going to follow these rules. We inequate this denominator to zero, that is x minus three should not be equal to zero. And when we solve for x, x should not be equal to three. Therefore, the domain of these functions should be the set of all real numbers excluding 3. The set of all real numbers excluding 3, which can be written like this, or we can write it in interval notation as from negative infinity to positive infinity, excluding 3, and this is how we exclude the 3. Negative infinity is not included, as you can see. 3 is not included because it is outside this. When the 3 is not inside this cap, it is outside, no matter where its position is. So we can read this as from negative infinity to 3 from below, and it continues from 3 from above to positive infinity. So in interval notation, this is how we exclude 3. And this particular value, when x is equal to 3, this function is undefined. This type of values are called asymptotic values. So x equals 3 is a vertical asymptote, as you will see in upcoming lessons. So another way to write is like this, the set of all real numbers minus the set x equals 3, or minus this set containing the elements a singleton 3. Let's take the second one. The second one, we have 5 minus 4x, since there's x in the denominator, should not be equal to 0. Here we are inequating, and x should not be equal to 5 on 4, because if x is equal to 5 on 4, this function will be undefined. So at this value, now the domain should be a set of all real numbers, excluding the value 5 on 4. So in interval notation, you have from negative infinity to positive infinity, we exclude this 5 on 4, as you can see, just like we did with 3, we exclude it. So this is rational functions. Let's take two more examples. So we have h of x equals that. In this case, the denominator is a quadratic. We can factorize. When you factorize, we have x minus 5 into x plus 1. So there are two values of x here. X should not be equal to 5, and x should not be equal to minus 1. So we have the set of all real numbers excluding minus 1 and 5. And in interval notation, we can write this as from negative infinity to 1 from below. Then we continue from, minus 1 from below. Then we continue from minus 1 from above to 5 from below. And we continue from 5 from above to positive infinity. So this is how we exclude these two values. So it's still a set from negative infinity to positive infinity, but we have now excluded minus 1 and 5. Please, if you don't get this concept, you can watch these videos over again and master the concepts. Be very careful with the way these signs are written. At these signs, we have what we call the boundaries. So if you look at this function, how many of these signs do we have? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So we have 6 boundaries. And what's the importance of this? It therefore means if they say you look for the limit at the domain of definition or at the boundaries of the domain of definition of this function, they're expecting me to have 6 limits. If I can combine some, no problem, but they expect me to have 6 limits. That is at negative infinity, at minus 1 from below, at minus 1 from above, at 5 from below, 5 from above, and at positive infinity. With the other ones, you have been having 2 bounds and 3 and 4 bounds. Now, this third question, since this one is a very tricky question, be very careful with this one. Look at the denominator very well. Take care of this question. Be very careful with this one. If you look at the denominator, x squared will always be a positive number. In fact, the denominator in this question will never be equal to 0, no matter what you do. No matter the value of x, the denominator will always be greater than or equal to 1. If x is 0, the denominator will be 1. If x is 2, it will be 5. And so on. So there will be no value of x for which the denominator will be equal to 0. And since the denominator cannot be equal to 0, it means this function is defined for all values of x. So the domain of this function is the set of all real numbers. This function has just 2 bounds. Be careful with this function. And another thing you have to note here is that complex numbers or imaginary numbers are not considered in the world of domain of definition of functions. So don't say that we have plus or minus I, which is complex numbers. The domain of definition is not defined for complex numbers. So since this denominator is always greater than or equal to 1, the domain of definition of this function is just a set of all real numbers. Because this function, the denominator will never be equal to 0. That's the reason. Let us now move to radical functions. And what are radical functions? Radical functions are functions that have roots. Radical functions are functions with roots, like square roots. In this case, we emphasize on and stay on square roots. So radical functions or square roots, the core should be positive. The square root of all numbers exists. We don't consider the square root of negative numbers. Zero is a square number, and the square root of zero is zero. So it therefore means that if you have a root, then the square root should be such that the core should be greater than or equal to zero. What do we mean by the core? We mean what is inside that root sign. That's what we refer to as the core. So let's look at an example here. We have this function 3 minus x to get the domain of this function. This function only be defined if what is inside the square root sign is greater than or equal to zero. If it's equal to zero, this function will be defined, but the square root of zero is zero. If it's greater than zero, it will be defined. But if it is less than zero, this function will be undefined. So what do? You have to use inequalities to solve. So this core should be greater than or equal to zero. And when we solve x here, you see that x should be less than or equal to three. X should be less than or equal to three. Why less than? When you divide both sides of an inequality by a negative number, whenever you divide or multiply by a negative number, the inequality sign reverses. That's what has happened here. If you have issues on this, you can equally look at chapter one of this A-level pure math series. This is a series we are seeing in season one. Season two is on statistics, and season three on mechanics. We have some of the lessons already existing on GCE math panel, the channel. So the domain of this function will be the set of all real numbers less than or equal to 3. The set of all real numbers less than or equal to 3. Or we can write that the set of all real numbers excluding values of x strictly greater than 3, like this. And in interval notation, we just have from negative infinity to 3. Now, this way I want you to focus. Whenever we have this radical function, that is square roots, these boundaries have some funny ways of behaving. Look, this function will be defined if x is equal to 3, because 3 minus 3 is 0, the square root of 0 exists. That is why this 3 at this position is inside. You can see the blinking cursor. This 3 is inside this cap, as they call it. Students call it cap, so I'm using the common word that they have been using. So it is defined, so x is equal to 3 in this case. X can be equal to 3 because you can see that this function is defined when x is less than or equal to 3, not strictly less than. If it was strictly less than, then the sign will be facing the other direction. This 3 will not be inside this house or inside this cap. So the boundary here is included. Be careful with these functions. Let's take also g of x equals x minus 2 and x plus 1. Now, this is a rational function, which also is a radical function. So this is a radical function with a rational inside. We will consider the rules for radicals and also consider that for rational. So the first thing is that what is inside the square root sign should be greater than or equal to zero. Should be greater than or equal to zero. And another thing is that the denominator here should not be equal to zero for this rational function. The denominator should not be equal to zero. So as you can see, the numerator can be equal to zero. This function will be still defined because the square root of zero is zero. But the denominator should not be equal to zero. It will make this function to be equal to infinity, and the function will be undefined. So we have to work with these two equations, and then we come out with the domain of definition. So, with this second condition, x should not be equal to minus 1. And we can use a number line to get this. So, the boundary solutions for this first part, where x minus 2 over x plus 1 should be greater than or equal to 0, we have normally the numerator can be equal to 0. So, we have x equals 2 when you solve this one. So, we have minus 1 and 2 as boundary solutions. But this 2 is included in the boundary because if x is equal to 2, this function will be defined. That's why we have shaded the 2. But minus 1 is not shaded, means that minus 1 is not included. So we can proceed by testing which region where this domain lies. Because it's an inequality, we have a range of values. That's why we're using this method. You can equally use the tables. There's no problem with that. It's the same. So we can test between minus 1 and 2. Let's test. Like 0, for example, fit minus 1 and 2 in this inequality. We can take 0 and test because it lies in this interval. We have 0 minus 2 is minus 2, or 0 plus 1 is plus 1. Minus divided by plus is minus. And the negative number is not greater than 0, so this region is not the correct region. Let's take any number above 2 and test here and see. For example, 3. 3 minus 2 is positive and 3 plus 1 is positive. So positive divided by positive gives us positive. Therefore, any number greater than or equal to 2 will give a good value. Even any number less than, strictly less than negative 1, will equally give us a good result. Therefore, the domain of definition of this function is a set such that x is strictly less than negative 1 and x is strictly is greater than or equal to 2. X is strictly less than negative 1 and greater than or equal to 2, as you can see here. So in interval notation, you can write it as from negative infinity to 1. You can see here that the 1 is not included. But look at 2. 2 is included. It has been written in a special way. 2 is included. You can equally see on this number line here, 2 is included. That's why 2 is inside. 2 is inside this cap, we call it umbrella. It's not outside the umbrella. So positive infinity. That's the domain of this function. So we take note with these functions. If you have any issues on inequalities like this, you can equally go to chapter 1 and refer and check. We are in chapter 5 already. Then don't forget to click on the subscription button, guys. And we have the notes. The particular notes for this can be obtained from GCE Maths Panel Classes Online. If you just go to the blog there, you have these notes on this lesson and the notes of all the lessons that you have. Now let's look at exponential functions. Exponential functions, the domain of exponential functions. So if the exponential function has no variable denominator, then its domain is a set of all real numbers. Let's take, for example, determine the domain of definitions of the following functions. We have e to the power 2x minus 3 e to the x plus 2. So we consider this type of exponential function as a polynomial function. And this is defined for all real numbers. No matter the value of x, this function will have a numerical value. So the domain is a set of all real numbers from negative infinity to positive infinity. Let's look at the second case. You have x e to the power x. Now, there is something about e to the power x. No matter the value of x, e to the power x will never be equal to 0. So we can still consider this one as a polynomial function. Though it's a composite function because it has that it's a function of another function, but it's a product of functions. You have the function x and the function e to the x. It's a product of functions. If you consider just this x, the domain will be the set of all real numbers. And if you consider e to the x, the domain will still be the set of all real numbers. So the domain here is a set of all real numbers from negative infinity to positive infinity. Now, x e to the minus x. This case is not different from this other case because no matter the value of x, e to the power minus x will never be equal to 0. So the domain will still be the set of all real numbers. And note that x e to the minus x can be written as x over e to the power x. And this domain is still the set of all real numbers from negative infinity to positive infinity. So we continue with exponential functions. So as we said before, if the exponential function has no variable denominator, then its domain is a set of all real numbers. Now look at this special case here. We have f of x equals e to the power x plus 1 over e to the power x minus 1. So the question you ask yourself is there a possibility of e to the power x minus 1 having a value of 0? The truth is yes. So this one, we consider it as a rational function, and then we solve. So this denominator should not be equal to 0. e to the power x minus 1 should not be equal to 0, we solve this in equation. We have e to the power x should not be equal to 1, and 1 is the same as e to the power 0. Therefore, x should not be equal to 0. Because if e is equal to 0, if x equals 0 in this equation, you have e to the power 0, which is 1 minus 1, 0. That will make the denominator to be equal to 0, and this function will be undefined. So the domain of this function is a set of all real numbers excluding 0. However, look at this function. If the denominator here was e to the power x plus 1, then the domain would just be the set of all real numbers, because e to the power x plus 1 will never be equal to 0. Take note of that. Now let's look at the second one. This is an example of what I've just mentioned. If you look at this denominator here, e to the power x plus 3 will never be equal to 0, because this plus 3 here will make sure that this function is always greater than 3. And e to the power x is never equal to 0. So you have to leave on something that is greater than 0. So this will be strictly greater than 3 for all values of x. Therefore, the domain of this function is a set of all real numbers, because the denominator in this case will never be equal to 0. Okay, there's more. So for logarithmic functions now, this is second to the last set of functions. So any function of the form log f of x is defined if this f of x is strictly greater than 0. You know, we don't have the logarithms or the ln of negative values. So this is the condition you'll be applying here to look for the domain. So for example, we have find the domain of the function f of x equals ln 2x minus 1. So as we have said, this core 2x minus 1 should never be less than or equal to 0. Or in other words, 2x minus 1 should be strictly greater than 0. So we solve this inequality, and x should be strictly greater than 1/2. Therefore, the domain is from 1/2 to positive infinity, right? And the 1/2 here is not included in the domain. So you can see from 1/2, the 1/2 is not inside the umbrella, so it's not included, to positive infinity. Take the second example, g of x equals ln absolute value of 2x minus 1. Recall that this absolute value makes everything that is inside to be positive. Everything that is inside to be positive. So in this case, what is inside this core should not be equal to 0, because everything that will be here will always be positive. Therefore, the only condition we don't want is this core becoming 0, because ln 0 will be undefined. So here we just that this 2x minus 1 should not be equal to 0, because this is an absolute value function. Whatever I put inside here will be positive. It will make it positive if it is negative. So the only problem when this core is equal to 0, since it's an absolute value function. And from here, x should not be equal to 1/2. Now see how the domain will be written. Set of all real numbers excluding 1/2. So when you look at these two, the first example here has two boundaries or two bounds. While this second one, the absolute value has four bounds, negative at negative infinity, at 0.5 from below, 0.5 from above, and at positive infinity. Now we have the ln of a rational function. So we are going to apply the rule for rationals and the rule for logarithms. So in this condition, this core should be strictly greater than 0. Another condition is that this denominator should not be equal to 0. Equally, if this numerator is equal to 0, this function will be undefined. So the boundary solutions are x should not be equal to 1, and x should not be equal to negative 2. And that's why we have not shaded anyone here, because if x is equal to minus 2, this function will be undefined. If x is equal to plus 1, the ln of this function will be 0, and ln 0 does not exist. So minus 2 and plus 1 are both excluded. Now we can test. Let's test any value between minus 2 and plus 1. Let's take, for example, 0. If we fit 0 inside this ln function, you have 0 minus 1 is minus 1 over 0 plus 2 is 2. The ln of minus 1/2 does not exist. So this region between minus 2 and 1 is the wrong region. Will not satisfy the conditions of this inequality. We can take another value now below minus 2. For example, minus 3 minus 1 is minus 4. But minus 3 plus 2 is minus 1. Minus divided by minus is plus. Positive number. Therefore, this region satisfies inequality. Because we want the condition is that x minus 1 over x plus 2 should be greater than 0. Equally, any number above 1 will still satisfy this inequality as well. So the domain of this function is the set of all real numbers from negative infinity to minus 2 from below and from 1 from above to positive infinity. So that's in interval notation. So x is strictly less than minus 2 or x is strictly greater than 1. We have four boundaries here. This is a very good example. You have to look at it very well. And then we have g of x equals x plus ln absolute value now. So we want to work with the same function now in case of absolute value. So this x here has is not our point of focus because it is a set of all real numbers. Now let's look at this other part of the function, which is the ln absolute value. So this absolute value, what's inside the core should not be equal to 0. So x minus 1 over x plus 2 should not be equal to 0. And this denominator should not be equal to 0. Equal, if the numerator is equal to 0, this function will also be undefined. So we have two values of x to solve for. Numerator should not be equal to 0, and denominator should not be equal to 0. So x should not be equal to 1, and x should not be equal to 2. And that gives us a set of all real numbers excluding 1 and minus 2. Just these values. So the domain is a set from negative infinity to minus 2 from below. And then we continue from minus 2 from above to 1 from below and 1 from above to positive infinity. So that's the domain of definition of that function. Let us take some examples of composite functions. For example, x plus 1 ln x. So we can consider these two parts of the function. This function is defined for all x plus 1. So we forget about this part of the function because it's set of the domain here is set of all real numbers. But for ln x, it will be defined only if this core, that is x, is strictly greater than 0. So the domain is a set of numbers that x is greater than 0. So as we have said, for this part x plus 1, the domain is a set of all real numbers. But for this other part, ln x, the domain should be shown such that x is strictly greater than 0 because the ln of negative numbers is not defined. Therefore, this gives us a combined domain as set of all real numbers from 0 from above to positive infinity. So such that x is strictly greater than 0. So for composite functions, we consider all the functions and remove and exclude the various values or range of values for which the function will be undefined from the set of real numbers. Equally for x plus 3 over x, root x minus 1, this is a rational function with a radical. We can consider this also as a composite function. For the numerator, the function will always be defined, but for the denominator, the first thing that the denominator should not be equal to 0. So x minus 1 should not be equal to 0. And x minus 1 should be strictly greater than 0 because the square root of negative numbers does not exist. So we can take greater than or equal to, x minus 1 should be greater than or equal to 0. But since this is in the denominator, we will take only strictly greater than, because if it's equal to 0, the denominator will give us a value of 0 and this function will be undefined. So we just have the denominator x x minus 1 to be strictly greater than 0. Yeah, so x minus 1, rather x minus, not plus, to be strictly greater than 0. And when we solve this equation, we should have x to be strictly greater than 1 as a domain of definition of this function. So this gives us x should be strictly greater than 1 for this function, that is plus 1. That should be strictly greater than plus 1 for this function. And this is the domain of this function. Now we have some exercises here. If you cannot get to lay your hands on the exercises, you can move to our block. You see maths panel classes online, and you go to advanced level, select math advanced level, and when you go to advanced level, you have this in chapter 5, lesson A. So look at the domains of all of these functions. For this first one, the numerator has no problem. That's not our point of focus. Here, the denominator should be strictly greater than zero because this root is the denominator. So x should be strictly, that's x2 minus x should be strictly greater than zero, minus x should be strictly greater than minus two, and x should be strictly less than two. X should be strictly less than two, but if x equals two, you have zero. If x is less than two, one, for example, you'll be defined and so on. But if x is greater than two, this function will be undefined. This one, you have already seen an example. E to the x minus one should not be equal to zero. Therefore means that x should not be equal to zero, because if x equal to zero, this function will be undefined. For this one, the domain is set of all real numbers, because e to the power x plus one will never be equal to zero. For this one, this absolute value should not be equal to zero. That is 2x plus 7 should not be equal to zero, and x should not be equal to minus 7 on 2. Here, we just consider the ln x since e to the power x is defined for all values. So x should be strictly greater than zero. And here, this denominator should not be equal to zero. The numerator should not be equal to zero. Apply those double conditions. And they all continue. This one to this e to the power x plus 1. Should not be equal to zero. Normally, this e to the power x plus 1 will always be a positive number. So this denominator is always greater than zero. In fact, it's never negative. And then the numerator will just focus only on this 2 minus 3x. For this question 9, we just focus just on the core of this ln. For question 10, we just focus on this ln. Question 11, we don't have anything to do. The answer is already there in question 12. So don't forget to subscribe for more videos that are coming in. Stay tuned and share these videos with friends. We have equality challenges. Please do this, answer these questions and see how much you have learned. Thank you so much, and stay tuned.
Bye-bye.